My name is Alec. I'm one of the ministers here at St. Mary's. It's a joy to have you with us in the building. Welcome if it's your first time here or your first time back in a while, especially. Welcome to you. Welcome as well if you're joining at home online. You're very welcome and very glad that you're able to tune in with us during this time. And just to say that for your convenience, if you do need to use any of the facilities, bathrooms or anything like that, they are just out of these double doors to the right. Don't worry about if you need to use them during the service, you're very welcome to. As we gather together, we've been listening to that first song, we've been reflecting through the words of that song of the honour and glory and power that is deserving of our Lord God. And so we meet this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Now today, as we come together for this service, we're going to just start by taking a moment. I'm sure everyone will have heard of the news of the last couple of days of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh, passing away. And so we're going to take a moment at the start of our service to remember him and remember the royal family in prayer. And just to say that some people have been asking about a condolence book. There is an online on the Church of England website, the National Church of England website, you can find an online condolence book, which we're encouraging you, if you want to leave a message of condolence, to sign on that online page, to fill in your message there. However, we also recognise that not everyone perhaps has access to the internet who would like to leave a message of condolence. So we also have a physical book here in the church, which is available on Sundays, but also is available during the week, during office hours. So if you're unable to access the internet, or you know someone who is unable to access the internet, but would like to leave a message of condolence, then they can come during the week or on a Sunday to leave a message. And the book is just to the right of me today. Let me start with a prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, the life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But you are forever, from everlasting to everlasting, and we put our trust in you. For you have promised never to leave us or forsake us. Loving Lord, in the last year, through the worst of a global pandemic, we've been face to face with our fragility and vulnerability, perhaps for some of us as never before. And so, against that backdrop of hurt and loss, we give you thanks for the life and service of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh. We recognise that some are called to the front of the stage and others to supporting roles, and we rejoice in the way that he supported Her Majesty the Queen through all the years of her reign. We remember too his work supporting charities, particularly his patronage of the Duke of Edinburgh Award Scheme. So in this hour of loss, we offer our heartfelt prayers for Her Majesty and her family. We ask that you would comfort them in their loss, bind up their wounds, and grant them the consolation of a store of treasured memories. Grant Her Majesty the peace that comes from knowing you and which passes all understanding. And these and all our prayers we ask in the name of Jesus, who through his life, death, and resurrection offered us hope instead of despair, and life instead of death. Amen. I'm going to hand over to Dave Wood, who's one of our readers here at St. Mary's, and he's going to lead us through the rest of our service.
So welcome. It's great to see so many faces. It's lovely to see actual people. As I probably put that in front of the camera. I just want to welcome you. And I don't know what sort of week you've had. You know, it might have been a fantastic week, it might not have been, but we're in spring. And the thing that strikes me when I come into church today was this beautiful arrangement on the cross here. And as we come to worship God today, it just strikes me that, you know, from the pain and the suffering of the cross, something beautiful occurred. We're reminded with the flowers here on the cross of that. As we come to worship in hope. Whatever your week has been like, we now have the opportunity to say, Jesus, we praise you. And so I'm going to hand over to our band. Stand up if you'd like to. I always forget to say that. But you can do, you don't have to. It's totally up to you. However you feel is the best way to praise God, you're invited to do that. just want to say, hallelujah, it's in Christ that we stand. It's because of Christ's love that we stand here. Now, I've worked for people with addictions for over 20 years now. And one of the things that I've observed is that people in recovery get things wrong. We're a bit like that. We don't always realise it, but we're in recovery. That word repent comes from this Greek word, metanoia, which is about using the whole of our being and turning around, continuously turning around and following Christ and jumping after Christ. And we can stand here with hope, knowing that we get things wrong, knowing that we're going to make mistakes, but not being beaten down by that. If you're here this morning or at home and you feel beaten down and you feel you haven't been the person you want to be this week, Christ says, come. And we come now and we say sorry to God. We say sorry that we're not always what we could be. The glorious creation we're meant to be. So we say together, most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We've not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be. That we may do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. I think we could have done an amen just before. The fact that Christ has put the way in front of us for us to walk in. Amen to that. So, as people who are forgiven, sometimes it's just good to remind ourselves what we believe. And we do that now with our creed.
Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried and raised to life on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received and this we believe. Amen.
Is there any more? Amen. I'm sure we believe so much more, but that is fundamental to what we believe. And Malcolm, Batman and
Robin.
I was hoping she would say the boy ones up.
Little man. Right, so let's move on. For those who don't know me, my name is Malcolm. I'm part of the 0 to 18 team here at St Mary's and have been for a little while. They call me the senior worker. I'm the oldest, in other words. We're just about to start. Next week, we start a new series in the 0 to 18 in CYP at home and here at church as well. And it's a new series which is going to last about 9 weeks. And it's about, what's it about, Rachel? There was a reason I bought this. No, it's not apples. Fruit. It's about fruit. That's right. It's about the fruit of the Spirit. It's about the fruit of the Spirit. God says, you used to live this way. But now you're following Jesus, you're going to look like this. This is how you'll be from now on in. I'm not much of a gardener. I leave all the gardening mainly to my wife. My parents were really good. My dad was an excellent gardener. I only really enjoyed the time of the year when you could pick this stuff. I didn't really enjoy the rest of the year. But I moved here 23 years ago. I know it's hard to believe because I'm only 24 now. 23 years ago, I moved here. And a few years after we'd been here, we went to Lidl. I don't know if anybody's been shopping at Lidl recently. Outside Lidl, they have quite often have plants, don't they? And I know some of you probably from Heswall and you call it Lidl. Is that right? But here we go. I went to Lidl and I bought a tree. It was like a little tree. And it said fruit tree on it. And I thought that'd be nice in the garden. We'll plant a fruit tree. And so we planted the thing alongside the fence at the back. And we sort of looked after it, you know, put a bit of water on it. It was definitely in soil. It definitely got a bit of light. I think there's a problem there because it didn't get really enough light. But it wasn't for years and years and years that we realised what sort of fruit tree it was. You see, we knew what sort of tree it was by the fruit that it produced. And that's the only way you could tell. You know, you look at this bush, it didn't have a sign, well, it did have a sign, but it just said fruit tree. We didn't know specifically what fruit it was until 5 or 6 years later, it produced a pear. I know you're all looking at me thinking, why didn't he have a pear in his hand? A Sainsbury's doesn't open until 10, does it? And I had an apple in the house, and the pear tree hasn't produced anything but flowers yet. But it wasn't for a number of years that we knew what sort of tree it was, and we knew what sort of tree it was by the fruit that it produced. Some people say, I'm a bit like a fruit. They say, Malcolm, you're a peach. That's what they say. Thick-skinned with a heart of stone. But that's the joke for this morning. So we know what sort of tree it is by the fruit it produces. And the Bible says that we know that you're a Christian by your fruit. It describes the fruit as love, joy, peace, and 9 different attributes. I'm going to call them flavours of the fruit. There's a few things to remember this morning. First one is, there is no CYP at home. So if you're at home looking on the site, there isn't a video this week, I don't think, when we start a new series next week. A few things that I want you to remember. First one is that the fruit is singular. You know, sometimes we look at that list of attributes, love, joy, kindness, goodness, gentleness, look at those, and we go, well, I'm a bit short on gentle, but I've got lots of joy. The Bible says that when we turn to Christ and we follow Jesus, we grow, we mature, we produce fruit, singular, all of those things. It's no big coincidence to me that when I look around our church and I see some of our more maturing, senior people in the church, that what I see in them is all the attributes of the fruit. St. Sally Shan springs to mind. I met her years ago at camp, and I saw in her all of the fruit. I understood then that following Jesus meant that you produced fruit, and that fruit is how people know that you're somebody who follows God. That's how you know. It's by the fruit that you know that you're this person's a person who follows God closely. So that's what we're going to be looking at over the next few weeks in CYP at home and here at church. Those different fruit, the love, the joy, the peace, the gentleness, the kindness, each of those. I prefer to think of them as flavours. You know, when you bite into an apple, you get different flavours, don't you? And so it's the same one fruit, but with lots of flavours. And you will grow. There's something inevitable about the fact that when God plants his seed in your life, that you grow. You grow. Now, there are some things that help you grow. So what helps the apple tree grow, or the pear tree, is it needs... I'm no biologist. It needs some nutrients. Is that the right word? Yeah. It needs soil. It needs water. And it needs light. And that was quite key to me because the pear tree was too close to the fence. It wasn't until 6 or 7 years it got to the height of the fence that it suddenly went wild because it needed more light. And if you're going to grow as a Christian, there's certain things that you might need as well. You might need to pray. You do need to pray. You need to read your Bible. You need to understand more about God. And the best way of doing that is reading your Bible. And you need to hang out in church, in fellowship, the Bible uses it, in community. They're the things that will help to produce fruit. Now, the other thing that is really obvious is it's not instant. You know, it took years to get a pear off that tree, and now we get a bumper crop every year. It's not an instant thing. So if you're at home or here and thinking, well, I've been following Jesus for a bit, but I don't seem to be producing fruit, I'm still a grumpy old what's it? Well, welcome to my club. I'm a grumpy old what's it as well. Here's the thing. You very rarely see the fruit in yourself. Very rarely see the fruit in yourself. If you see the fruit in somebody else, if you see the joy or the peace, or if you see goodness or faithfulness in somebody else, you need to encourage it. You need to go to people and say, that's great, I see the fruit of God in your life. Very rarely do we see it in ourselves. We tend to look at ourselves and see the faults, and see the things that we do wrong, the mistakes that we make. Last story. Jimmy went to camp with me one year. And Jimmy, on that camp, decided that he was going to make God the undisputed boss of his life, and he was going to be a Christian from then on in. A week later, I bump into Jimmy. He'd been back from camp a week, and he comes up to me and says, I'm already the worst Christian you can imagine. I've done this, I've done that, I've done the other, I've not done the right things. And I went, oh, just keep going. Just keep going, Jimmy. I walk around the corner, I bump into Jimmy's mum. And the first words that mum says to me is, do you know, he's a changed boy since he's come back from camp. He's a completely different person. He's doing stuff around the house. And you see, it's a different perspective, isn't it? So I think in church, if we see fruit, we need to encourage it in each other. We've got a couple of slides up here. Let's have a look. See if it works. Oh, there's my ball patch. Where did that come from? They always seem to get that angle, these camera people. That's why he wanted the camera lifted up, wasn't it? Couple of slides, Ivan, have we got them? There we go. Oh, little slides. We're just about to start Sunday School Live again. And this is the way we're going to do it. So next week, you see, I think that's the 18th next week, we're going live with Seed and Grow and Jam. So if you're in those age groups, you can come to church and join in those groups again. So if you've got little tiny kids up to the age of into year two, reception year two is Jam, then come along and we'll take you to a separate place and we'll do some separate activities with you. It'll be loads of fun. If you happen to be an explorers or pathfinders, the next two age groups, the stuff online will be for you to look at. It will be in your age range. The CYP at home will be for you, and vice versa on the other weeks as we lead up to the summer. Obviously, it's not a roadmap. It's a phased return, this. And we don't know what might happen, do we? But this is what we're hoping is going to happen as well. Can we have the other slide by the place? Here you see that the groups are starting 9:30 in the parish church. CYP at home video, I've mentioned that, will be on the YouTube channel for the other age group that aren't live that week. And don't forget to book on the all-age service when the all-age service is. Always the first Sunday of the month. And we have tables and toys and stuff to loads of running around and fun. And Claude, our big red puppy, always comes to that one as well. So remember to do that. And if you're of an age, a teenage age, and you were missing a drop-in over at the bank, that too is starting soon, and you can book on limited number of spaces on each session. It's a bit of a trade description problem. It's called drop-in, but you have to book on. So we're going to call it book on instead of drop-in. But it's the same sort of thing. You book through our website and make sure you book your spaces. I'm going to pray, and then we'll get on with the day. I know it's a rhyme. It's only a crime if you do it all the time, isn't it? So let's just pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that you sent your Son, Jesus, to save us and to show us the way to live our lives. Thank you that your Spirit is placed inside of us, and we thank you that you grow within us fruit. Help us over the next 9 weeks or so to learn more about that fruit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Malcolm. Just two other items of family news, really, for us to be aware of over the next week or so. One in relation to what Malcolm's been telling us about our Sunday groups and the drop-in book on at the bank returning for teenagers, is that from Monday the 19th of April, down at the centre in Sogomasi, we're going to be relaunching a sort of rejuvenated tot spot. So for little ones and their grown-ups, again, you will need to book on if you'd like to attend that. But it'll be on Monday mornings from the 19th of April down at the centre. It's suitable for sort of 0 to 4-year-olds and their grown-ups to come along to. So if that's something that you'd value, or you know of someone who would really value that, please do let them know. Please encourage them to book ahead, because obviously numbers will be limited with social distancing. But that is a really exciting thing as we move forward, as we phase our return. And also on that same day, on Monday the 19th, in the evening, we'll be beginning a Christianity Explored course, a chance to explore the Christian faith, to ask questions we may have, to find answers, to look at the life and death and the resurrection of Jesus and the claims he made. We'll be hearing a little bit more about that shortly. Just please, if you receive the notice sheet regularly, please do have a look at it for all the other things that are going on. But they're the two things I really want to flag for you this morning. I'm going to hand over to Dave now as we turn to God in prayer.
Malcolm, I think I've identified a second fruit for you. You might be a peach, but you're also a right banana. That's okay. Malcolm said it's about keeping on going. And as we pray, I really want us to focus on that. That we're in a marathon. We need to keep going. So Lord, we come to you and we step into your grace. We step into your love. We want to be fruitful. But we know that just trying doesn't make fruit. It's being the right plant. It's being grounded in your love. Grounded in your word, nourishing us, in your spirit, watering us. And being that plant that's willing to grow in your love. From the light of the sun. From the light of Jesus. So Lord, today help us to maintain our focus, maintain our need for you. We pray too for our community, Lord. We pray for Upton. We pray that Upton might know and experience more of your love. That right here in Upton, your spirit would be at work, transforming people's lives. For the mundane, the small things that happen every day, that your seeds would grow and your fruit would be apparent. We pray for the Wirral. We pray that the Wirral might be a place characterised in your kingdom. That place where heaven and earth meet. May that be amongst us, Lord, and may we be part of that. May we commit our lives to bringing your kingdom to the Wirral. We pray for our nation and our world too, Lord. We see so much suffering, inequality, injustice, and pain, and we sometimes wonder, where are you, Lord? And we know that we can do that. We know that we can come to you with our questions, and know that even if we don't get the answers, that you are in control. And we pray that for our world this morning, Lord. Give us faith to see you at work. We pray for our leaders of this church here. We pray that they might know your guidance, your wisdom, your compassion. We pray for our national leaders, that they might know that too. That as we steer through COVID and we have this return to normality, that you might guide our next steps and make us a people who are willing to follow. Let's do what's right. We pray for members of our congregation too, Lord, who are not feeling well or happy or content at the moment. Give them a fresh experience of your grace. Let us be a people who are blinded by your grace, Lord. And Lord, as we come to the word, challenge us, Lord. Riches. Give us a glimpse of that spirit of yours, Lord, that presence of yours, which is beyond our understanding. And may we be motivated to be changed by it, Lord God. Amen. And we join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Dave. It feels a bit like musical statues today, doesn't it? Sorry for all the back and forths that we've been having. We're going to do something slightly different as we come to God's Word today, as we think about God's Word and what He has to say to us. Something slightly different from a normal Sunday sermon, and that's because we're going to be taking a moment to think about the wonderful claim of Easter, the central claim of Christianity, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that He proved it by rising from the grave. And so I want to start this morning by reading a passage from the New Testament, from a letter written by someone whose life was utterly transformed by an encounter with the resurrected Jesus Christ. And that is the Apostle Paul. Now, Paul himself is like a piece of evidence for the resurrection. We'll come to that a bit later, but here are the words of a man who was devoted to persecuting, opposing, and silencing the followers of Jesus. And yet he was so utterly transformed by an encounter with the risen Christ that he became one of Christianity's strongest advocates, someone willing to suffer all kinds of things for the name of Jesus, even to die for Christ. And so I'm going to read from something he wrote, which is taken from his first letter to the Corinthian church in chapter 15, verses 1 to 12. And that will come on the screens for us as well here in the building and at home. And this is what Paul says to the Christians in Corinth. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you've taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise you've believed in vain. For what I received I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, and that is Peter, and then to the 12. After that he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. And then he appeared to James and to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles, and do not deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God was with me. Whether then it is I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believed. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Paul says, this is what we preach, this is what we believe. Here is the heart of Christianity summarized for us in a short reading. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from death. This is a belief which the whole of Christianity stands or falls upon. And so we wanted to take a sermon, a Sunday, just to think, reflect on the evidence for this, the evidence for the resurrection. To ask ourselves, if the tomb is empty, what is the evidence for the resurrection? Because Paul says a bit later on in that chapter, he says, and if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is futile. You're still in your sins, and then those who've fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If for only this life we have hope in Christ, we of all people are to be pitied. See, Paul's basically saying, if the resurrection of Jesus didn't happen, we may as well pack up our bags and go home. The resurrection is everything. And that's why we're asking the question today, what's the evidence for the resurrection? Can we trust it? Now, if you're a Christian watching this, then I hope that you'll be encouraged in your faith. That perhaps some of the objections that you might hear from others might be answered, or that some of your doubts personally might be alleviated. And if you're listening to this, watching this here in the building, and you wouldn't necessarily consider yourself a Christian, or maybe you're interested, but you're not sure yet. Perhaps you've got questions, or you're considering matters of faith. Then what I really hope to do in the next few minutes is to dispel a myth for you. And here's the myth. The myth is that to be a Christian, you have to make this completely blind leap of faith into the dark. What I hope to show you is that actually, that there is good evidence to build a case as you consider the central claim of Christianity. But what I do want you to know is that as you consider this evidence, at some point, you will be required to take a step of faith. Not a blind leap in the dark, but based on the direction that the evidence is pointing. On that first Easter Sunday, a step of faith that believes a miracle happened, that Jesus rose from the grave. And so that's what we're going to do today, is consider some of the key pieces of evidence, if you like, that support this central claim that Jesus rose from the grave. And along the way, we'll, as we consider the evidence, we'll also review some of the objections that we might hear from people, perhaps objections that we ourselves might be wondering about. Now, what I suppose I want to say from the start is that there's no way we can say everything that there could be said. And I can remember, I can recommend a whole lot of things that you could go away and watch or read that would help in this exploring this further. I've compiled a little collection of short books called The Case for Easter at the back of church. If you wanted to on the way out, you're very welcome to take one of those, have a read of it. I'd love to chat to you once you've read it and see what you made of it. So please do help yourself to one of those if you'd like to. And as we take in this evidence, we're going to be listening to some New Testament sources, as well as to some external sources outside the New Testament, some historical accounts, including the New Testament. And we're recognizing that these are eyewitness accounts. We're not going to dismiss them. We're going to listen to them. I suppose like in a court, a judge would not dismiss the evidence of someone who was a witness simply because they knew the party. So we're not going to dismiss the evidence of the New Testament simply because it could be described as biased. We've got to listen to what it says, just as in a court we'd listen to the evidence of a witness. So here's the first piece of evidence that we're going to consider. And it's a piece of evidence that feels kind of counterintuitive, but it's this. That Jesus really did die by crucifixion on the first Good Friday. Jesus died by crucifixion. There are very few historians, Christians or otherwise, that would dispute this fact. The historical figure, Jesus, did actually die by crucifixion at the hands of the Romans. Now, there is a bit of an objection that goes like this. Well, maybe Jesus didn't actually die on the cross. Maybe people thought he was dead. And so they buried him in a tomb, as it's recorded, but they made a mistake. And actually, Jesus had sort of fallen unconscious or been drugged or collapsed. But he wasn't actually dead. And perhaps after he was put in the tomb, and is in that cold tomb over a period of a day or so, his body had time to recover. And some people would argue that in that sense he resuscitated, but he wasn't resurrected. He didn't actually die and then rise. And they'd say, well, that explains why people saw him on occasions afterwards. Now, just a couple of points on this objection. There are very good reasons why few historians dispute the fact that Jesus actually died. The first reason is what early historical sources tell us. See, there's plenty of early historical records, both from the New Testament and sources outside the Bible, like Jewish and Roman historians, which confirm the wide acceptance that Jesus died. There are no early historical records of people saying Jesus didn't actually die. Now, second, the more that we find out about Roman crucifixion, the more we realize that the idea of Roman soldiers mistaking Jesus as dead is completely unrealistic. Crucifixion was not a torture method. It was a deliberately slow, excruciating, humiliating execution method. And the Romans were absolute experts at it. We have no historical records of anyone, anywhere, surviving a full Roman crucifixion. And without being gruesome and going into the details, the Romans even knew how to speed things up if it was taking too long. And Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor, he personally oversaw the trial of Jesus over this punishment of crucifixion. He knew that a riot would begin if Jesus was accidentally mistaken as dead. He made sure that it had happened. There's no way he would have let a mistake like that happen with the tension in Jerusalem at the time. And when we read what happened to Jesus, the more impossible resuscitation seems. He was already so weak from the flogging before his crucifixion that he couldn't carry the cross. The abuse beforehand was enough to kill a person. But in addition to this, his side was pierced to check he was dead. At which point, John reports rather gruesomely that blood and water suddenly flowed out, which medical experts today think that means that his stomach had been pierced. And then he's embalmed in tight burial linens, sealed with this mix of perfumes and spices. And so do you see how impossible the idea seems that after all of those things happening, a nearly but not quite dead Jesus was mistakenly placed in a tomb, a stone was rolled over it, and that somehow on the third day he was able to unwrap himself, or unwrap all the linens, push the stone away, walk around the garden, walk the 2-hour journey to Emmaus and back all on the same day, and then get back to Jerusalem in the evening in time to drop in on the disciples. That just isn't going to happen to someone who's been crucified. The historical evidence tells us that Jesus died by crucifixion. So now that we've established that Jesus really did die, we've got to turn then to the claims of Christianity that Jesus didn't stay dead. And this is where our second piece of evidence comes in. You see, we might have heard people say, well, sure, I believe that Jesus died, but the idea of him rising again, well, that was a legend that developed over time. You know, over a longer period of time, the church constructed this sort of resurrection legend that the first Christians didn't follow themselves. So our second piece of evidence for the resurrection is this, that historically early accounts of the resurrection. You see, legends take hundreds of years to develop, usually through oral traditions, and eventually they're written down. Like King Arthur and Excalibur, the Knights of the Round Table. Those things come down as legend over hundreds of years. But we have very early historical records that teach us that the resurrection of Jesus was not a gradually developing legend, but a belief that defined the early church from its first days. And that's one of the reasons I read from 1 Corinthians chapter 15 at the start, because this is a creed of the earliest church. We actually read part of it as our creed earlier in the service. It's a creed of the earliest church that was based on the eyewitness accounts of Christians. He says, "For what I received, I passed on to you." You see, Paul has received that belief and he's passed it on. Paul preserved it by writing it down, but he wrote it down only about 25 years after Jesus had died. And so he had passed the contents on to this church in Corinth before he wrote to them. He'd been to visit them, he passed it on, and then later he wrote to them saying, "For what I received, I have passed on to you." So this creed that Paul passed on was before the letter he wrote 25 years after Jesus. And now we know shortly after Paul's conversion, he meets with some of the other apostles, including Peter and James, and they confirm those beliefs together when they meet. So really, when we're talking about the accounts of Jesus' resurrection, we're not talking legend. We're talking about something that was established in the church within months of Jesus' death. We have more early reports throughout the New Testament, but we also have early reports of the resurrection outside of the Bible. The Jewish historian Josephus, writing probably just a couple of decades after the death of Jesus, he directly references the early church and its belief in the resurrection. He's not a Christian historian. He's a Jewish historian, writing as a friend of Rome. So we have early historical accounts telling us the resurrection isn't a legend developed over time, but a foundational belief of Christians from the very beginning. So we have that. And that means our search for evidence goes in a slightly different direction. If we know Jesus died and we know the early church claimed he was alive, then why didn't the Roman and Jewish authorities just do the obvious thing and go to the tomb, roll back the stone, and show everyone the body of Jesus? If this was all fabricated, why didn't they nip the rumours in the bud before they could spread? Well, clearly, if they could have, they would have, but they didn't, because the tomb was empty. So that brings us to our next piece of evidence, which is something we need to consider, the empty tomb itself. How do we justify the tomb being empty? You see, the whole of the New Testament asserts that the tomb was empty, that the women who visited the tomb early on Sunday, Peter and John who heard the news and ran straight there to find it, the guards at the tomb who report things back to the priests about what has happened, even the Jewish leaders who opposed Jesus, who had him crucified, they don't deny that the tomb was empty. You see, when the disciples begin proclaiming that Jesus was risen, what the enemies of Jesus said was not that the body was still there and we could go and check, but they said the disciples stole the body. See, they acknowledged that the tomb was empty, and they circulated a rumor about the disciples stealing the body in order to cover up the fact. Now, I suppose it's a bit like an employee who arrives late for work because they've overslept. They could come in and say to their employer, "Oh, the traffic was absolutely terrible today." Now, they're not denying that they're late for work, acknowledging the lateness, but they're coming up with a different explanation. I suppose it's a bit like a school child saying to the teacher, "I haven't got my homework, the dog ate it." See, they're not denying that they didn't do their, they're not denying that they haven't got their homework. They're just coming up with a different explanation of why it's not there. You see, the Jewish leaders who had Jesus crucified, they weren't denying that the tomb was empty. They were just coming up with a different explanation of why it was empty. So the question is, well, how did it get empty? Some people might argue that the Jewish leaders, that the disciples of Jesus, they came perhaps in the dead of the night when the guards had fallen asleep maybe, and they stole away the body of Jesus. So, is this the greatest hoax ever performed on mankind? Well, let's consider that claim that the disciples stole the body, that objection. First, a Roman guard that was at the tomb, that isn't one or two individuals. It's a group, perhaps 15 or 16, well-trained, armed, drilled soldiers who really don't want to face the punishment from a Roman authority for falling asleep on the job. Second, I think about the state that the disciples were in. Where are they when Jesus is crucified? They're scattered. They've run away. They've fled. Peter and John are in Jerusalem. But where are the others? They've all gone. They're depressed. They're afraid. They're leaderless. Are they really going to risk their lives to come back to fight off a Roman guard to steal Jesus' body? What would they gain from such an act? They've got nothing to gain, but they've got everything to lose by doing that. Why would they risk it all for this? What would they gain from pretending Jesus was alive? We can look at the lives that the disciples go on to live because of their claim that Jesus was alive. And what we see is that the disciples suffer because of that. And they're persecuted. They're attacked. Some are killed. Yet they devoted their lives to spreading the news that Jesus was resurrected, that he defeated death. If they knew from the start that it was all a lie, that it was an elaborate hoax, that they'd stolen the body when the guards were asleep, if they knew from the start it was a lie, why would they bother dying for it, suffering for it, when they stand to gain nothing? Now, I think the best explanation of the tomb being empty is that Jesus truly did physically return from the dead. And so the fourth piece of evidence is this. The multiple independent accounts of Jesus alive after his death. You see, there are separate accounts of people saying they saw Jesus after his death. Eyewitness accounts of him appearing to men and to women, to individuals and to groups, in rooms or on beaches, when eating meals, and even to large crowds of 500 people at one time. Now, some people at work might object and say, well, those accounts, maybe they were hallucinations, you know. They were the hallucinations of desperate people seeing what they wanted to see. But actually, the disciples didn't expect to see Jesus. That's what is striking about many of the encounters with Jesus. They don't even realize it's him straight away. They're not expecting to see him. They're surprised that they see him. And we know that hallucinations don't happen to large groups of people at the same time who've got different psychological makeups. And even if that did happen, different people wouldn't hallucinate the same thing together. And what we know, medically speaking, is that often, psychologically, hallucinations, they get worse and more severe over time if the person isn't given appropriate care and treatment. But for the followers of Jesus, the sightings of Jesus stop suddenly after 40 days. That happens for everyone. It's not that these hallucinations get worse and worse and worse and keep going, but they stop suddenly after 40 days when they claim that Jesus ascended to heaven. So hallucination isn't an adequate explanation of the multiple accounts of people seeing Jesus alive over a period of 40 days. Now there's more we could say, but time has run away with us a bit. So let me just suggest one last piece of evidence to consider as we close. And that is this, and I think it's extremely significant, the change in the disciples' lives. From weak and fearful disciples on Good Friday, something happened that meant they would devote the rest of their lives to boldly proclaiming the wonderful news of the death and resurrection of Jesus, even being willing to suffer themselves because of it. There was a change too in the people who even opposed Jesus. Jesus' half-brothers, including James, they opposed Jesus before he died. They didn't believe him. They rejected him. But after Easter, after they've had an encounter with the risen Jesus, even James, one of Jesus' brothers, went on to proclaim his resurrection. He went on to refer to himself as a slave of Christ, to lead the church in Jerusalem. And Paul, who we considered at the start, or Saul as he was known, who breathed out threats against the church, who persecuted Christians, who approved of their stoning, Paul encounters the risen Christ and as a result devotes the rest of his life to proclaiming Christ's death and resurrection, though it means suffering dearly for it. So I think the evidence is pointing us in the direction of the resurrected Lord Jesus. And the resurrection changes everything. It shows that Jesus is the Son of God, as he said he was. It shows that he is the true judge. And after all this, it's not him who will be on trial, but us. It shows that forgiveness is available to all who seek Christ. And it shows that we can have hope in the face of death. C.S. Lewis, the author of the Narnia books, put it like this. Something perfectly new in the history of the universe had happened. Christ had defeated death. The door, which had always been locked, had for the very first time been forced open. I don't presume to have answered every question that you might have or have solved every puzzle. But I do hope on hearing this that you can move, perhaps if you were in a place assuming that to believe in Christianity is a blind leap of faith, that you can move to an understanding that actually, with the evidence in front of us, belief in the Lord Jesus, in his death and resurrection, is a step of faith that rests on the evidence we're given. If you want to further explore any of this, you're very welcome to take one of those books, as I've said, or to join our Christianity Explored course, which begins next week. We'll be meeting together for that. You'll need to book on so we can get the numbers right, but please do. That's an opportunity to ask questions, to consider the claims of Jesus, to explore more for yourselves. said enough. So let's pray as we reflect on those things. Loving Father God, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have conquered death and given us hope of eternal life with you. And so, Lord, we pray as we consider today the evidence for the resurrection, that you would help us to step back and look at it and consider it, that you would bolster our confidence or renew our questions and our inquiring faith. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to sing our closing song now, which reflects on that great act of love of Jesus, his death and his resurrection. And please stand or sit as you feel able to join in. Amazing grace.
Encourage each other with that as the words of the grace appear on the screen. is just remember and encourage. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore. Amen.
So let's go in grace, let's go in peace, let's go in hope, and let's go and take God's love, the resurrected Jesus' love, to our communities. As you do so, just on a practical note, please do so by that door as opposed to that one. Thank you.